It's the Montreal Just for Laughs Comedy Festival. Kevin Hart presents LOL at JFN.
I'm happy to be here. I'm happy to be here because, it's the Just for Laughs Festival, and it's great, and being a comedian is a special job. And I have immigrant parents, so they don't give a fuck that I'm here. They just don't. Immigrant parents don't give a shit about your job. I remember telling my mom, I'm going to Just for Laughs Festival. I'm going to be doing a bunch of shows. She goes, wow, that's crazy. What is Just for Laughs? And the worst part is, mothers are getting different. Everybody's getting different. Like, the world is changing and it's growing, and I can't handle immigrant parents getting older. Like, does anybody here have their parents on Facebook? Clap if you got your parents on Facebook. Let me hear you guys right now. It's fucking shit. You see how unhappy that clap was? The worst part is that immigrant parents don't understand. Like, if you have Canadian parents, they know what it is. They finish sentences off right. They know how to do things. My mom doesn't know how to do anything. I got her a tablet for Christmas, and at first she didn't know how to use it. She would just like everything on Facebook. You know, you log in, 30 likes from your mother. And nowadays she's learning how to write in English and shit, and it's fucked up because she doesn't comment correctly. She doesn't know how to do it. Like, the other day I posted a picture of me smoking weed during the sunset. And my mother seen the picture, and I it was okay picture. I got like 10 likes, you know, whatever. And my mother wrote on it, oh my God, you crazy? You guys want to know? I got 32 likes. And that's not even the worst part. Worst part is that she called me. She goes, you see her picture? Nobody wants you to smoke drugs. 32 likes, huh? You see that? My mother's always been against weed and drugs and shit like that. Like, in this audience, let me feel you clap. If you never smoke weed, you don't like it, let me hear you right now. 5 people. Clap if you have smoked weed in your life. Let me hear you right now. Clap, yeah. You hear how much happier the second group was than the first group of people? Second group's got stories. My mother always used to think that drugs was going to come into my life. She'd always say, the police going to catch you. They're going to bring you home on drugs. I'm going to say, fuck you. I swear to God, it's because I grew up in a neighborhood with crackheads. If you grew up in a neighborhood with crackheads, immigrant parents don't give a shit. I remember one time I was standing at a bus stop with my mom when I was a little kid, and a crackhead came up, and my mother was annoyed, and he just kept going, excuse me, excuse me, excuse me, do you have change? And I'll never forget, my mom goes, huh? Excuse me, excuse me. Why you not change your life? And you can see in his face like, what the fuck just happened? They're usually the nicest. The world is this weird place now, man. You know what else is weird too? Like, I was talking about parents getting technology and getting on Facebook. My father retired a few weeks ago and he asked us for a present. And we go, what do you want, Dad? He asked for a cell phone. Isn't that kind of nice? 65-year-old man asking for a cell phone. You guys want to know why? Because we showed him you could watch porn on a cell phone. Okay. I heard one lady go, aww, he's fucking whacking off. You know how funny that is? And the best part was, when we showed him, it was like a revelation. My father's in his 60s. He doesn't know what the fuck he's signing up for, man. And we're at the cottage, and we're looking at a cell phone, and we're laughing at YouTube videos. And I'll never forget, he goes, hey, why are you guys laughing? And we go, Dad, we're watching videos on YouTube. He goes, videos? You watch the video on the phone? And we go, yeah. He goes, you can watch anything? And we go, yeah, anything. And my cousin goes, hey, man, you can watch people have sex right now. You ever see your parents break character? Do you know what I'm talking about? That your parents are normally this person, like, what the fuck is going on? Change your life. Get a fucking job. You ever see your parents like, yeah, man, hey, what? Porno on a phone, huh? Like, you know what I mean? I'll never forget. As soon as my cousin went, hey, you can watch porno on a phone. My dad just broke character like I've never seen. He goes, what? Come on. Come on, man. Come on, show me. Come on, let me see. And he walks over to us, and I'll never forget this moment because he leans in. He goes, hey, what are you guys going to show me on the phone? What is this? And we go, Dad, you can watch anything, man. You can see anything. What do you want to see? The nice Catholic man that he is. I swear to God, he goes, I don't know. Let me see a lady have sex with a man. And we go, yeah, of course that's what you want to see. But what kind of lady? What kind of man? You can see anything. And my father, I swear to God, goes, I don't know. Hey, you guys can show me this. Show me a lady have sex with a black guy. We go, why? He goes, I never see, but I hear a lot of stuff. I swear to God. And my father hasn't seen a dick since 1977 in a porn. He has no idea what the fuck he's signing up for now, man. Okay? A dick in a porno isn't a dick anymore. It's fucking on GMOs, man. It's a fucking, okay? Monsanto grows porno dicks nowadays. And I'll never forget the moment that, okay, so we pull out the cell phone, and he goes, oh, my God, what are you guys going to show me on the phone right now? Oh, yeah, we got that. Relax, man. He goes, watch. Look at this guy. We showed him this guy named Mandingo. Oh, my God. The one black lady in the front like, Mandingo. I'm just joking. Show's over. Everybody go. We have an interview with Shaniqua. Mandingo. She like, get that dick out my face. That's a microphone. So we show Mandingo to my dad. And he kind of reacted like that, actually, man. We show my dad Mandingo on the cell phone. And he goes, hey, why this guy have a towel? He's scared to show the peanut or what, huh? And the minute the dick comes up, my dad goes, hey, wow! Holy shit! And he looks at me and goes, hey, tell me the truth. This thing's real or no? I go, Dad, it's real and it's not even hard. He goes, fuck you! I don't believe it. I go, believe it, buddy. And the second the dick goes in, my father just, he can't do it. He's an old Catholic man. He just can't do it. Because you can hear it on the phone. You hear the lady go, ah. My dad goes, hey, I can't see this. I can't. He slaps the phone down. He goes, I can't see this. Tell me the truth. She gonna be okay? Hey, you guys have been absolutely fucking amazing, huh? Come on, baby. Thank you, everybody.
Gives you perspective on culture and how upbringing of different people will lead to different senses of humor. You learn that someone who grew up in an Asian community has funny different types of Asian humor. A black dude has the funniest types of, you know, sly funny humor too. Some white people are just uptight and funny because it's not about telling jokes to your friends, it's about making everybody laugh. Every culture, every age, you make them all laugh and it helps a lot on stage.
How you guys doing? Hey, yeah. I'm gonna tell you a story. I got invited to a party, which was big for me, okay? I don't get invited to a lot of parties, all right? I get there, I didn't know there would be hard drugs at this party, you know? And like, I don't judge or anything. It's just that someone offered me heroin, right? Like, here's the hierarchy for me, is that, like, weed, everybody understands weed, hey, whatever, you know what I mean? Cocaine, you're living on the edge. Crack, you've made a mistake. But no one doing heroin has a 5-year plan. No one, okay? If you do heroin, you either play the guitar really well or you just have a lot of feelings. I don't know what to say about you. So he offered me heroin like it was normal, and I didn't want to not seem cool, but I didn't want to take the heroin. And so he passed it to me, and I was like, no thanks, man. I am stuffed. I could not have any more heroin today. I have had my fill. I am good. Thank you. I live in New York now. I moved to New York from Chicago, and I wasn't ready. Lots of things I was not ready for. One was the rats. I don't know if you guys have rats here, but no one has rats like New York because the rest of the world's rats have shame. I saw a rat inside, all right? And he saw me see him, and instead of scurrying away, he was just like, what's up, dog? Like, that's... What is that? What is the... And I'm 800 times bigger than him. I could step on him and kill him. And he was like, but you won't, though. Like, that, I'd never been more scared. I saw... My friend got a cat. Got a cat and was like, it's so great. She eats all the, like, she eats little roaches. She might even get after a rat. The cat was scared of the rat. The cat was like, I'm fine. I'm gonna get on this ledge and wait for him to leave, all right? It's devastating. The other thing I wasn't ready for was the third graders. I don't know what it is about being born and raised in Brooklyn or the Bronx that makes you such a natural bully, but they're monsters, okay? I'm terror. They're little terrorists, all right? I'm more scared of third graders now than I was in third grade. I actually asked to get off work early so I could make sure I was in my house when they got out of school because I didn't want to run into them anymore. They're little monsters. Like, I was just walking down the street, and one was like, hey, hey. First of all, too much bass for a third grader, all right? I turned around, almost called him sir by accident. I didn't know who was talking to me. I turned, he's like, hey. What's up, bird shoulders? I don't know what that means. But I went home and cried afterward. You ever have someone make fun of you and it does, you don't even get it, but it hits such a core part of who you are that you get hurt anyway? Like I was sitting, my body hasn't changed since it happened. I probably still have bird shoulders. I have no idea what it is. I have a lot of fears since I'm little. You know, I'm scared of a lot of things. My biggest fear above like rats or third graders or anything else is just finding a dead white girl. In fact, I think that's why there's no black ghost hunters, because we don't want to come in a room and just... I'm too black to just find her. There's going to be an investigation. There's going to be leads, okay? People are going to be calling in. They're going to use a picture of me on the news. It's not going to be a good one. It's not going to be a picture with me looking like the first picture day or something. It's going to be me stubbing my toe like... And you're going to see that on the news and be like, he did it. Look at him. Who smiles bottom teeth first? He is a murderer. In fact, I'm so scared that I would walk in, see her dead, scream, someone runs and be like, what did you do? No, that was my scream. That was not her. I know it's hard to believe, but I screamed the way she would have screamed had this been me to her, but please don't. Okay, I'll go to jail now and I won't last. I had to take a flight. Another fear that's creeping towards the top of the list is tiny planes. You know, I had to take a tiny plane. I didn't think it would be a big deal. It only seated 8 people. It's the tiniest plane I've ever been on. And it was so small that there was no cockpit. So I could see the captain and the co-pilot. I could hear both of them. At one point during the flight, the captain was like, whoa. And I was like, what? Oh my God, what? No, don't act like I can't hear you, sir. We're talking right now, okay? Do I need to get up ahead? Don't tell me to sit down. I can't stand up. The plane's not that big. I should have known something was wrong because I got to the gate and they wanted to weigh my carry-ons. Which never happens. But I was like, fine, backpacks 13 pounds, laptops 4 pounds with the case. And then they were like, how much do you weigh? And I was like, how small is the plane? How small is the plane? You need to know my 125-pound body weighs 125 pounds. And then I get to the plane, I'm like, that makes sense. Okay, fair enough. It's the smallest plane I've ever been on. And, like, it took, like, this plane, I know it's not nice. I know it's not kind. But, like, I was the youngest person on this flight by far. Everyone else was 80 and up. So a real thought I had on the flight was, this is heaven's waiting room. I gotta get out of here. This is terrible. She already looked dead. So her soul just had to step out to get to heaven. I don't want to be up here with people dying. And you know that overhead compartment that's supposed to drop an air mask if there's too much turbulence? That's not there at all. It's just little Bibles fall out because you're gonna die. So you might as well get a verse in or something. You're dead, okay? It was terrible. And like, We were flying, and like I was having these heart palpitations and everything. I didn't know if I would last or anything. And then I don't know how planes work, okay? I can't pretend. I'm not a genius, all right? But at least the big planes take off right away. It took this little plane so long to take off, I thought we were going to drive there. This plane is actually leaving the ground and coming back down, and leaving the ground and coming back down, to the point where I looked at the pilot and I was like, do we all need to jump at the same time? What's gonna keep me in the air? I just wanna get to the place, please. Guys, I'm Josh Johnson. Thanks so much. You have a great night. Appreciate it.
It's the Montreal Just for Laughs Comedy Festival. Kevin Hart presents LOL at JFN.
Thank you. You don't clap. You don't give a shit. They didn't care. They were just over there. Fucking fuckers. Look at this. Wow, look at this crew. Brooklyn, dude. You ever go? It's wild out there. Because where I'm from, the part I'm from in Brooklyn, like, nobody gets off the block, you know? They're like, oh, Chris made it to the intersection. The other day, like, this kid's... But I travel, you know? You know where first place I went? Actually, England. I was like, oh, that's where they invented English, so this will be, like, an easy transition, but I was wrong. Different words mean different things, you know? Nobody told me that. Like, last name is not last name when you get there. They switch it up. Surname. I didn't know that. I get to the UK border. They're like, what's your surname? I was like, Sir Christopher DiStefano. Just cocky right away, Brooklyn, you know? I was like, Brooklyn Knight, you know who the fuck I am, all right? Give me all your finest meats and cheeses, so thank you. That's what they do, just change the TH to an F, and then you're British. Thank you. Sometimes I couldn't even understand what they were saying, like, so I would just make British sounds to try to, you know, I'd be like, thank you. Oh, off with your head. La la la. Brilliant all the time over there with the, oh, it's brilliant. This is brilliant. It's brilliant. That's a high honor of a word in the US. You can't just run around and say shit I do is brilliant. Like, I'll get emotional, you know? Nobody talks to me like, but over there, oh, look at that homeless guy. Look at him petting a dead ferret. Isn't that brilliant? I was like, bro, that's heroin, all right? Come on. He's on crystal meth. He's petting a dead animal, legit in public. So let's pick a new word and regroup, because liquor, they don't call liquor. They call it spirits. Nobody told me that. My friend was like, oh, you want to come to my place? Come on, we have loads of spirits. I was like, yeah, I'm not going to your haunted fucking house, all right? Nigel, no thank you. Let's just eat a Fig Newton and calm down. This guy fucking shirt buttoned up. You don't fucking give a shit. Good crew. You guys together? Wow. Where'd you meet? At a club. Classy. It's good shit. You know, fucking, yeah. We were on ecstasy. Next thing you know, I've been there. That's nice. That's a good, you know, my parents met at a walkathon. That's where they met. My mom was walking in the walkathon because she's a great person and she was raising money for breast cancer. And my dad was walking in the walkathon because he had lost a bet. So he was like, yeah, so then I had to walk in a walkathon like a homo, and I met your mother. And that's always how he says it, like a homo. It's like, what's gay about walking in a walkathon? But you have to understand, when you meet my father, he assumes you're gay. And then you have to work your way back to prove to him that you're straight. And if you mess up once, you're gay forever. I had a blueberry yogurt when I was 15. It's never been the same since. If he was here right now, he'd be like, lick the microphone, Chris, so you know you want to. Just give it a little lick. Shove it right at your ass. You fucking love it. It's hard, dude. You don't want to laugh. He doesn't want to laugh. He's on, you know, he's on a date. I don't approve of that. You want to go to the club? Okay. Maybe I'll grind on your ass, but I don't approve of that joke. So, whatever, bro. Good for you, dude. Everything. I got a kid. You guys have kids? It'll happen. You don't pull out. I fucking know. It's going to happen, dude. At the club, you don't pull out. It'll happen. I have a baby. Little girl. One. Beautiful. Half Spanish, half Italian. I named her West Side Story. Because you got to... But her mother's Spanish. Like, her mother's a crazy Puerto Rican Spanish girl. It's crazy. I literally fucking live my life minute to minute. I, like, use what I've learned in this minute, and then I just survive the next minute with the tools I got from the previous minute. You know? Like white girls, you know, it's the same thing. You know, you go home, you watch your shows. Like, I have so many shows. Like, I can't even fucking deal right now of watching my shows. But Puerto Rican girls, you're in the show. You're in it. You're in a Lifetime drama. Now, we're just out of nowhere. Boom, stabbed in the neck because she had a dream that you cheated on her. And, you know, you're dying in real life. Your blood pressure is going to be a fucking zero unless you can find your jugular and screw it back in. Dude, you know what I'm talking about. Dude, she's always watching me, 24/7, this girl watching, waiting, you know, she's just, there was all this controversy this year in the NFL, you know, about how the referees, they weren't doing a good job, they were like missing all the calls. I was like, well, you should have just hired Puerto Rican women because they see everything. So they would have, could you imagine that Puerto Rican women, Spanish girls running around as the referees? They would be right there like, you're out of bounds, stupid. So, yeah. I was waiting for your dumb ass to step out of bounds, and guess what? You just stepped out of bounds. So, I don't even know the rules. Just go home. Bye. You out the game. See you later. Bye. You don't mean it. What? I feel like she's here. I fucking feel like she's here right now. I smell the fucking spices. Good for you, dude. Good for you. Fucking at the club all day. She's Spanish? Is that what you said that? She's Spanish? Wow, that's... I'm not allowed to be within 5 feet of another Spanish woman. So, just so you know, I'm gonna get my dick cut off when I go home because of this fucking guy at the club. Good for you. That's nice. And so still sex and all that's good, right? It's got it. Spanish good. That's all I do. With her, that's all we do. We have sex, we do Zumba. That's the whole thing with me and her. It's unbelievable. I've been in relationships where it hasn't been sexual, though. One time I dated this girl, 3 years, I got one blowjob. Now you laugh, asshole, but now you hear this kid giggling? He hasn't laughed at one thing. Now he's losing his shit at my pain. I like the married guys are like, 3 years, one blowjob's pretty good, kid. What are you, a porn star? Fucking on fire. I haven't got one since 86. You know what the problem was? My mother loved her. My mother's like a very Catholic, you know, very religious woman. And every time I was like, Ma, look, that's it. I'm breaking up with Lauren. She was like, honey, no. Jesus will find a way. Can I promise you? I love that Lauren with all my heart and soul. Just promise mommy you will not break up with her. You have to stay with her. Jesus will find a way. Just trust in me. Trust in God. Jesus told me to tell you. She's the one. And I just snapped one day. I cracked. I was like, Ma, I know you like her. I've been dating her for 3 years. She's given me one blowjob. That's what I said to my mother. And she was like, Christopher! Get rid of her. That's all the business. Have a nice night. Enjoy yourself.
My best laugh out loud moment was probably in the 90s. I was at Yankee Stadium with my dad, and he's like a real tough Italian dude, and I wanted a Philly cheesesteak, and the guy was just being a dick about it. He wasn't like, I wanted like cheese, I wanted onions, and he was like, just like going through the motions, and my dad was starting to get pissed off. So my dad grabbed him from behind the car and shoved the Philly cheesesteak down his shirt and like into his pants and then punched him in the head. And I was like, that was hilarious. Like, it was scary, but it was also like, that was a funny moment, you know, where I was like, my dad's a psycho, but it's also like that, who stuffs it? You ever think as a Philly cheesesteak vendor, you're just gonna get a Philly cheesesteak stuffed down your pants and punched in the head?
This is great, I'm from England. I'm English, my dad is Irish, I drink a lot. That's how it works. I drink to self-medicate. I self-medicate with booze, which sounds awful, but I used to use sugar. Like if I felt bad, I'd eat loads of sugar. That's far worse, because that becomes a downward spiral of guilt. You know, like I've eaten an entire cake in public. It's embarrassing. You know, everyone's looking at you. You know, the wedding's ruined. But like, but alcohol just brings a fucking carnival atmosphere to a panic attack. It really does. I'm a big fan. I've been drinking a lot recently, mainly to forget. Because I recently broke up with my long-term girlfriend. Thank you. I mean, I did it. So people don't have as much sympathy when you do it. I mean, some people do. Some people say in many ways it's actually harder for the person who dumps. That's what I mean, it isn't. In many ways, it's harder for the murderer. Like, there's no way. It's still tough, though. Still tough. 5 years we were together. 5 years, and I was the one who quit it. I was the one who made the decision to quit, and I'm a stubborn man. I've never quit anything in my life. Nothing. I've still got all my shares in Blockbuster. I'm not letting any of this go. 5 years. But we reached a point, we realised we were very different people. You know, very different people. She's also very different to how you imagine. Like, you look at me, you maybe think I go out with a certain type of person. She wasn't really like that. I mean, you look at me, you probably think I've just drawn some tits in a shoebox. I'm calling it my girlfriend. It's not it either. But I don't know. There's a couple of things she said to me towards the end of the relationship that maybe summed up where we were. A couple of things. I'll say them to you now. The first one, I don't know why I'm telling you this, but it's Canada. I don't mind. I'll tell you. She said, you're not sorry you did it, Sean. You're sorry you got caught. Yeah. No, I hadn't cheated on her. No, I'd wiped a yogurt lid on the cat. But you know what I mean? It's just... not good, though, is it? It's not good. But now I'm single again. Now I'm single. I'm learning a lot about myself being single again. Learning a lot. Like, I don't know the best way to tell you this. I'm very bad at the sex act. I'm very bad. I'm not saying this to be cute. It's better when I come too soon. It is. It is. At least then I know what I've done wrong. You know, it's harder. I go 45 seconds up. I don't know what I'm doing. Put my penis in a different direction. Don't do my hands or my lips. I don't know when to get the Lego out. You know, I don't know when to pour vinegar on her head. You know, when do you repent? When do you pray for forgiveness? I don't know these things. But I tried to get better. I typed into Google how to get better at sex, enter. And the top article that came up was on like Men's Health Online or something. And the title of the article was, "Bring her to the boil in the same time as pasta." It's a bit seedy, isn't it? "Bring her to the boil in the same time as pasta. How to give your girl an orgasm in 15 minutes. I saw that and I thought, 15 minutes? 50? I've been seriously undercooking my pasta. I don't know. Tortellini's a two-minute job. I don't know what I'm doing. But the loneliness is starting to kick in. That's why I need to get better. The loneliness is starting to kick in. Like, I moved to London, as you said, I'm from London, where I don't know as many people, and I moved in with strangers. Well, they were strangers. I now consider them enemies. They're nice, they're nice. I live with two girls, they're lovely. But it's, I had to lie. You know, we had this meeting beforehand to see if we were compatible as roommates. I had to lie to get the place. I had to lie. I told them I was clean. You know, I told him I was successful because I couldn't tell him the truth, could I? I couldn't say, look, I mainly just eat bread and look at the wall, and when you're gone, I'm going to sniff your stuff. I couldn't tell them that. I couldn't tell them that. But it's hard, isn't it? Looking for a place to live. It's awful. I was legally homeless for a while. Legally homeless. That's rough, man. I would not recommend being homeless. I would not recommend it. Destroys you. Destroys your ethics. You know, you watch the news. You hear the anchorman say, elderly couple murdered at home, no suspects. But what I hear is, one bedroom property, unexpectedly available. It's very, lethal. But that's ethics, ethics change. And my ethics have been tested this year. I mean, God, a lot of stuff going on. I'm having to realise who I am, trying to think about all the stuff I am. Basically, I realise I'm a coward. That's the main thing, I'm a huge coward. Like, I've realised this, there is no cause on earth that I would die for. Nothing. That's a big thing to admit, because that's built into us from a young age. Like, I remember when I was young, I used to believe in things. I used to say, if I was alive in the Second World War, I'd have signed up on the first day, I'd have fought those Nazis, and I would have died, because freedom is worth dying for. Now, I wouldn't. Are you kidding me? Fight in a war? What are my options there, really? Get shot in a trench because of something somebody else did, or stay at home and have the pick of the widows? I know what I am. Why would you do fight in a war? I know I'm a coward and you maybe think I'm a coward. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with that at all. It's just there's this idea that there is an achievement in death. As we said, there's an achievement. There's no achievement in death. You're dead. It's the end. Live. This is the achievement. Live. Whatever it takes. Sell people out. Burn bridges, you know. It's not a hard life. It's just like Crash Bandicoot. You just got to eat apples and keep running. That's all you need to do.